Hello, I'm Tom Dozier, and this video is Misophonia Reflexes, a technical discussion. Now, this is going to go into the nitty-gritty of reflexes, how they develop, what they are. So if you're not interested, hit that stop button right now. But you've been warned. So I want to consider misophonia as a reflex reaction. You see, when you hear a trigger stimulus, you have this strong emotional response. And it's an involuntary emotional response. And one of the definitions of a reflex is an involuntary response to a stimulus. So I view misophonia as a reflex. Now there's coping responses, things we do after we're triggered. And these are generally purposeful behaviors, and they can be modified somewhat, yelling, leaving the room, covering your ears. Those are the kind of things that we do because they work for us. So we can modify this outward behavior, these coping responses, but we can't really reduce that internal trigger response by doing that. So what this video is going to be about is the science of reflexes and how they apply to misophonia. But first, I want to talk about other behaviors that we do. Now, most of the behaviors that we do, most of the things we do are purposeful behaviors. And those are things that work for us in some way. They operate on the world around us to produce some effect. And because that's they operating on the world around us, it's called operant behavior technically. And it's most of everything we consider thinking and doing is this purposeful behavior. And the way purposeful behavior works is that we see a situation, we have a need, we take an action, the behavior, and we get something. So for example, you want to go someplace, you walk out into your driveway, the car's locked. So you see the car, you see the key in your hand, you have a need to get in the car, you push the button, and the door unlocks, and you can get in the car. And your payoff was the door's unlocked and you're now inside the car. That's the way purposeful behavior works. But when we look at reflexes, technically it's called respondent behavior. It's a stimulus and then boom, there's this involuntary response. And the response comes from our muscles or our glands. It can be inside of us. It could be outward muscles that you can see. But these are automatic behaviors that we cannot choose to do or not do. And what we consider feelings and emotions, a lot of that goes into this reflexive behavior. So again, with reflexes, there is a stimulus perceived. It can be, you're going to see it, hear it, smell it, taste it, touch it, or something inside of you happens, and there's going to be this, boom, instantaneous response. For example, loud noise, you blink. Food in your mouth, you produce saliva. Those are involuntary responses. So these automatic actions of our muscles and glands, a lot of these we have at birth. And actually we have more at birth than at other times, and they just go away. For example, a baby sucking at first, when you touch the roof of their mouth, they will immediately start sucking. That's a reflex reaction, but it goes away quickly. There's other reflexes that are at birth and remain with us through our life. Blinking, knee-jerk kick reflex. There's some reflexes that develop during puberty, some of the sexual responses, some change in puberty in terms of intensity and speed, and some decline with age. I'm getting to the point where my response time, my reflex response is actually going down. That's a physiological change of that reflex response. But reflexes are your friend. They really are, because they keep you alive. Last night you slept, and while you slept, you breathed. That didn't sound right, but anyway, you continued breathing, and that breathing was a reflex response. All of our digestion processes are reflex responses that process the foods keep us alive. And there's also actions of glands that produce hormones that regulate almost everything our body does. And these hormones also have a large influence on our emotional responses. So some of the reflexes that we have, the muscle reflexes, are things like you hit the knee and the knee kicks. A loud sound happens behind you, boom, there's a startle reflex. Or someone scares you, there's a startle reflex. Sometimes things are happening and there's a reflex to tense up. For example, with anger, there's often a tensing of the muscles. Other reflexes, little massage on your back, your reflexes is to relax the muscles. Blinking, pupil constriction, breathing, swallowing, all the muscle movements with digestion, gagging, shivering to increase our body temperature. Those are all reflexes that are muscle reactions. There's also the reflexes that are from our glands that produce hormones. We eat a big meal of pasta and the glucose starts going up in our bloodstream and our body starts producing insulin. We're under stress, our body produces cortisol. We have certain situations where our body produces adrenaline, which increases our heart rate, gives us increased strength. We have endorphins that are produced. Those are feel-good hormones. Stomach acid is produced as the action of a gland. And sweating. When you're hot, you sweat. And that's the gland acting to release the water. Now, if we look at the brain and the brain structures here, I've got three identified. There are many more. But the top structure here is the cerebrum. And that's your thinking brain. That's all this, this stuff that our frontal lobe and all the different pieces there that we think with. There's the limbic system identified, which isn't really a system. It's multiple pieces of the brain that light up when there's emotions going on. And we consider that limbic system our emotional brain. And then down in the bottom of the brain, in the brain stem, is the autonomic nervous system, and that's your lizard brain. And the reason it's called the lizard brain, it's kind of the reptilian brain. It just reacts to the world around you. So if a lizard crawls up on a rock, certain kinds, they'll turn brown. Lizard crawls up over on this nice little leaf, he turns green. Does that lizard think about what color he's supposed to be? No, he just changes as a reflex because of his lizard brain, his reflex center. This autonomic nervous system is in the lower part of the brain stem. It's called the medulla oblongata. And it's actually a swelling that occurs at the top of the spinal cord, kind of the transition from the spinal cord into the brain. And it consists of two sections. There's the sympathetic or excitatory nervous system, which excites and ramps you up, and the parasympathetic nervous system, which is inhibitory and kind of ramps you down. And you have some conscious control over some of these reflexes, like breathing or swallowing or blinking. But, generally you don't have control over the reflexes. If I tell you now, don't sweat, I'll tell you, don't sweat, don't worry about it. But if I tell you, don't actually perspire, you're not going to be able to do it. And if I come up and make a loud boom behind you, you're going to jump. And you can't choose to not have a startle reflex. It just automatically happens. In fact, the startle reflex, I think, is very similar to what we experience with the misophonia reflex. So for misophonia, it's all about the reflexes and about your lizard brain that controls it, not you. So far, we've talked about inborn or innate reflexes. Misophonia is actually an acquired reflex. And this is how reflexes work in our body in many different ways. We pick up these different reflexes over our lifespan. And it's part of what makes life so wonderful. But with misophonia, it's really a problem. So here's how these acquisition or conditioned reflexes, the process is called conditioning to pick up these reflexes. You start with an inborn natural reflex. And there's two parts to that. There's the unconditioned stimulus, that's the natural trigger. And there's the unconditioned response or reflex. An unconditioned stimulus might be a puff of air in my eye, and the unconditioned response will be a blink. Now, this lizard brain of ours, it detects the stimulus and it causes the blink to happen. It perceives the loud sound and it causes the startle reflex. So if you look at the stimulus for an acquired reflex, it would be something that at first is called a neutral stimulus. It doesn't cause any reflex. You hear it, but there's no reflex response. So there's the crunch, and there's no response. There's a click sound, no response. There's a bell ding ding, no response. You see something, no response. You perceive it, but you do not have any instantaneous response. So acquiring a conditioned reflex, what happens is you have this neutral stimulus, let's say it's a click, and then there's the unconditioned stimulus immediately following it, the puff of air in the face, and I blink. Click, puff, blink. Click, puff, blink. Click, no puff, blink. And that's what that lizard brain kind of anticipates what the body's going to be doing, and it does it for you automatically. So there's extensive research in this, and it's very, very proven. It was identified by Ivan Pavlov, who was a research physician. He was researching digestion, and he was coming up, or his assistant was, but he's coming up to give meat to the dogs, let's say, and the dogs were producing saliva. So what he discovered is that as he came up to give the dogs the meat, they started producing saliva before they ever got the meat. And so he did an experiment where it was a ring a bell, meat, they'd produce saliva, ring a bell, meat, saliva, ring a bell, no meat, the dogs would start producing saliva. So timing is critical to develop an acquired reflex. It's the timing between the neutral stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus that causes the reflex to develop. When we do research on reflexes, and there's lots of research on reflexes, 0 to 5 seconds where the neutral stimulus precedes the unconditioned stimulus by 0 to 5 seconds is considered simultaneous presentation. And in humans, we find that for a muscle reflex, a half second lead where the neutral stimulus and then a half second the unconditioned stimulus, that's the most powerful timing for developing an acquired reflex. So click, half second, puff of air in the eye, I blink. And we say that the neutral stimulus becomes associated with the unconditioned stimulus, and therefore it becomes what's called a conditioned stimulus. Now, with misophonia, I look at this and say, what is the unconditioned stimulus that creates these huge emotional responses? And I can't find one in most cases. And so if there's no unconditioned stimulus, how can misophonia be a conditioned reflex response? Well, is the unconditioned stimulus really required? About a decade ago, Donahoe and Vegas found a reflex in pigeons that had a half second delay. And with that half second between their unconditioned stimulus and the reflex response, they were able to move the neutral stimulus before and after the unconditioned stimulus and test for the pairing to see whether it was the pairing of the two stimuli or if it was a pairing between the neutral stimulus and the reflex response. And what they found is that the critical relationship is the pairing of the neutral stimulus and the reflex response. And the reason we didn't know about this before is because every situation that they used, every time you had a stimulus, an unconditioned stimulus, there was immediately an unconditioned response, and so you couldn't really tell the difference as to what you were pairing and what was important. Now, there's some supporting research in this. where infants were exposed to vanilla odor within the first 24 hours of life, and they were continually exposed for 11 to 16 hours, or two different studies, and they were exposed when they were either sleeping in their bed or being held, and so there was no unconditioned stimulus. It was just this steady state, low emotional state, calm state. And what they did in one experiment is, after the infant was given the heel stick to draw blood, they let them smell the vanilla. And those who had had the previous experience with the vanilla calmed down much quicker. And in the other experiment, they swaddled the babies and let them smell the vanilla before the heel stick. And those who had had the previous experience of smelling the vanilla when they were calm and sleeping didn't cry. So this showed that the vanilla was an acquired trigger for a calm response. So it shows there's an emotional state that we've actually have a reflex of an emotional state that's affected by the experience, and it's a conditioned reflex that developed without an unconditioned stimulus. There's another research study that shows that this conditioning of reflexes starts at birth. When an infant is born, he or she does not prefer his mother's voice over anyone else. But with this experiment, what they did is they paired picking up the infant with the mother's voice. Pick up the infant, play the mother's voice. Pick up the infant, play the mother's voice. Do that 60 times. Then when the baby cries, you play the mother's voice. And you compare those infants who had this experience and those who hadn't, or who had heard their mother's voice but hadn't been picked up. And you find that those who were picked up and heard their mother's voice calmed down quicker, because hearing mother's voice was like getting picked up. So this shows, again, that a physiological emotional state, a calming reflex, is affected by experienced or conditioned reflexes. When we look at acquiring this misophonia reflex, what kind of happens, and it doesn't, you know, it's in the brain and it's so complex we don't know exactly how this happens, but essentially our autonomic nervous system, our lizard brain, perceives a stimulus and then it scans the body. What muscles are tight or tightening? What muscles are relaxed or relaxing? What glands are active? What other reflexes are happening in this 0 to 5 second window, with that half second delay between the stimulus and what's going on in the body being the most critical? So that lizard brain scans the body and sees what it can find. Now, when I talked with individuals and I got written feedback from some surveys on individuals about developing their first triggers, I thought initially it was related to trauma. Totally wrong. One woman said, "I loved my stepdad, but I was trapped in the car with my father when he was chewing gum. And being in that confined, trapped situation, hearing something she didn't really like, maybe a little upsetting, what it was, developed a trigger. I know of another case where the child was arguing with their brother at dinner, and their brother's chewing became her first trigger. And not only did the brother's chewing become the first trigger, but the muscles that she was tightening as she was arguing became her reflex response." Another woman said that she had to sit by her grandmother in church, and her grandmother was always sniffing, and that sniffing became her first trigger. One little sensitive little girl said that her father would yell at her brother for smacking lips at the dinner table, and the first trigger she remembers was her brother smacking his lips, not at the dinner table, but at breakfast. Okay? So you see, at the dinner table, it was a natural response of, oh, don't yell, Daddy. But then that was that father, there's a lip smack, and So at breakfast, lip smack, and there comes that response. I've got one individual who said they remembered developing their first trigger. This is very rare. And what happened is he had anxiety. He shared a room with his brother who had allergies at this time. So he's laying there with his anxiety and tension and the muscle tension that goes with that anxiety. And hearing his brother's nasally breathing, he can't go to sleep. So he goes in, finally, after a while, he goes into the living room and he goes to sleep. But after that night, whenever he heard his brother's nasally breathing, he triggered. And I know of a 40-year-old man who developed misophonia. It's not age-related, doesn't have to be. And he developed it to mockingbirds, to chirps. A mockingbird built their nest outside of his window. Kind of cute having a bird nest outside your window, except mockingbirds chirp 24 hours a day. So he's laying there, can't sleep, chirp, chirp, chirp of the mockingbirds. So he developed a misophonic response to all five distinct chirps of the mockingbird, and it's now spreading to some other bird sounds that have some similarities. Well, if we look at how this reflex is acquired, I think the way it works is we take a physiological state of distress. You're anxious, tense, stressed, angry, and that has accompanying physical muscles tight, stomach is knotting up, something. And I kind of see two acquisition processes. One is I've got this state of distress, kind of a tense muscle, and there's an irritating sound. So here's my muscle, and I've got this, it's kind of tense, and I have this irritating sound, the crunch, and it tenses, crunch, and it tenses, crunch, and it crunch, and I keep getting that tighter and tighter and tighter muscle constriction because there's something irritating or upsetting about that trigger sound. The other acquisition process, I think, is totally independent of the sound and the reflex. I've got these tight muscles for any reason. I'm just angry and upset and yelling at my brother over something, and I'm hearing crunch, 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 crunch. And that forms that connection between the crunch and that tight muscle. So simply put, distress plus a repeating sound equals misophonia trigger. If we look at the emotional response, misophonia is characterized not as a physical reflex phenomenon, but as an emotional response. That you hear a trigger sound and you have these extreme emotions. And patients and individuals in surveys have told me that they have no physical response. It's strictly emotion. In one survey I did about a year and a half ago, 18% said that their only response was emotional. They never had a physical response. And 12% said that sometimes they had a physical response, but sometimes that it was only emotional. So 30% of these people said they experienced a misophonia at some times where it was strictly emotion, nothing physical. But what I found after careful testing or in a treatment situation, about 95% have a physical reflex. Now there's another 5% that we can't identify any kind of physical reflex, only emotion. And most of those are older individuals who've had a lot of trauma experiences, negative experiences in their life, so there may be something else at play here. One girl I worked with reported that she had only rage, just that was her immediate response, but in the treatment setting, her response was clearly visible. There was a clearly visible shoulder jerk in the process of her treatment. The other thing I find is that in treatment, the physical reaction is separate from the emotional reaction. And I find that interesting. And I'll cover that, go into that more in a minute. Now, these different physical reflexes, what do I find? Almost any muscle, you name it. Arms, fists, closed, fist opens, chest, abdomen. One woman reported a pain in the sternum and the front and the back. It's kind of like you're gasping for breath with your windpipe closed. Shoulders, back, buttocks, legs, feet, jaws, eyes, foreheads. One person reported, actually two now I've had, muscles behind their ears tweak when they hear the trigger sound. Pain of the ear seems to be fairly frequent, but I think that always so far has come with another physical reflex. I think the pain in the ear is due to a muscle tweak in the ear that controls the volume that's made to reduce the volume when there's a loud sound. Constriction of things inside your body, the stomach constriction, intestines, kind of unknown movement up in the chest area, esophagus tightening, kind of choking you, nausea, a couple of urge to urinate, eye jerk, goosebumps on the arms, and a sexual arousal. So almost any reflex response can be a misophonia reflex response. And typically we consider misophonia as this one-step process. I hear these sounds and I have these enormous emotions, right? Extreme emotions and fight or flight response. What I see is that it's a two-step process. First, there's a trigger stimulus and that elicits this physical reflex. And this physical reflex elicits the extreme emotion or the fight or flight response. Now, there is some development over time. It appears that we develop a direct connection between this trigger stimulus and the emotional response directly. But that's not the primary path as I see it. It's trigger, physical reflex, and the physical reflex causes the extreme emotion. And in treatment, I find when we stop the physical reflex, that we stop the emotional response without treating the emotional response directly. Well, if we say, what about this emotional response? People with misophonia have tried to stay calm, but they can't stay calm. They just can't. Now, if you look at some research in aggression, there's a study where they put mice in a cage side by side and they shocked the mice electrically, boom. And the mice turned and attacked each other. See, it didn't matter where the pain came from. There was a sharp pain and they immediately attacked. That's called pain-induced aggression. So with misophonia, the trigger sound is heard, the stimulus, and the lizard brain kicks off this reflex, which if it's a muscle jerk, that's an electrical shock. That's what makes muscles move. And because you've just been shocked, then you turn and get angry. It's kind of like when I've stuck up behind my mother when I was a kid, and I would shock her, I would make a noise, then she would jerk, and then she would get mad at me. And I think that's very similar to what's happening with misophonia, is that the trigger elicits this muscle jerk, and muscle jerk causes the extreme emotion. Now, there's also anticipatory anxiety that goes with misophonia. That's similar to a soldier walking across a minefield. A person has good reason to be anxious going into a room where they're going to get pelted with all these electrical shocks and from the triggers. So if I want to understand how misophonia triggers spread, it's the same kind of conditioning process. When I get misophonia the first time, I'm pairing a neutral stimulus with this emotional response, with this physical response. And in real life, if I'm being triggered by a sound, then any neutral stimulus in the environment can become another trigger. So essentially, if I'm being triggered and I'm hearing other sounds, those other sounds can become triggers. And so triggers spread, kind of like an infectious disease. It's really kind of, if you look at these things that develop, for example, the gum chewing is a big trigger. And the jaw movement, people chewing gum, is a big trigger. So they're hearing the pop, pop, pop of the gum and they're seeing the jaw move. So there's a visual stimulus perceived, the triggers reaction going on. The lizard brain puts that together and says, when you see the jaw move, do that reaction. And it becomes an independent trigger. At the dinner table, a child is triggering to a chewing sound and you're hearing the sound of the clanking and of the cutlery and the different table sounds. Well, those become trigger sounds also. Or I'm hearing, I only trigger to dad, but while I'm triggering to dad, I'm also hearing other eating sounds of family members. Those other eating sounds become triggers as well. We also find with these triggers that many times they're highly discriminated, meaning they're very specific sounds and context. I had a 15-year-old boy in my office, and we were testing him. It's actually the first person I worked with, him and his mom, and he triggered to his mom's crunching, and I got some Fritos, faced him against the wall, and I put a Frito on my mouth, a little piece, so it wouldn't be too big, crunched it, and he goes, no, no, that's nothing. Mom puts one in her mouth and goes to crunches it. He goes, ooh, that's it. He could tell the difference in the sound of mom crunching and me crunching. So it can be very specific to both context, the people, situation, and to the sounds. And it can also generalize or spread where I'm hearing one specific crunch as my first response, and then I'm hearing slightly different variations, and I'm starting to trigger to those. And then I'm hearing other sounds, crunching sounds at the same time, and it slowly spreads to more and more wider and wider, wider sounds to other people and other places. And that's called generalization of the trigger response. There's really very complex controlling stimuli when we deal with conditioned reflexes in general. And with misophonia. Generally, it starts with one person in one situation, and we add these other sounds over time, but it can be very selective. I worked with a woman who triggered to the crunching of her granddaughter, but I couldn't trigger her. She triggered to gum chewing of her mother as a kid, but to her good friend, she didn't trigger at all. It was a very pleasant sound. I know a woman who triggers to almost all eating sounds of Americans, but not of Chinese, because you see in China, loud eating is a compliment to the host. Therefore, she sees it as socially appropriate and she doesn't trigger. Now, in the moment, she can't think, oh, this is socially appropriate, don't trigger. It's much more complex than that. We also find that triggering is influenced by your general mood. And so if you're fatigued, or sleep deprived or hungry, then you're gonna trigger worse. So getting rest and fed and staying out of stress helps to reduce the triggers. And that the research in general research in conditioned reflexes shows that this was with animal research, but if you eliminate the reflex in one situation, one context, it can still occur in another situation, in another setting. So it's very complex. There's something that's called respondent extinction, where these reflexes will die out. And it's very clearly documented in the research. And there's formulas that empirically show this is the way it's going to decay. Essentially, if you break the connection between this conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus, which is also the unconditioned response, then what you have is just the conditioned stimulus, the trigger, and the conditioned response, which is a little bit less than the full unconditioned response. And that if you then repeat it again, the trigger, you'll get even lower reflex, the trigger again, even a lower reflex, and it dies out exponentially. Once again, this is called respondent extinction. But with misophonia, it doesn't die out. And I ask myself why, and my idea, do not have proof in this, is that you hear a trigger and that creates this reflex. And then there's this emotional boost, ugh! And so the lizard brain is going, I did this, but I'm seeing this, so next time I'll do it harder. And so that's also why experiencing real-life triggers over and over tends to strengthen that reflex response and make it worse. But if we would have no emotional boost, if we would just go crunch, trigger, oh, and then crunch, trigger, crunch, trigger, crunch, trigger, crunch, trigger, and it would die out. So what we want to do is we want to try to have the trigger, to eliminate this reflex, we want to try to have the trigger and then do something that causes, instead of causing the full reflex, it causes a reduced reflex. And these special conditions are called counter conditioning. A couple of ways that we could do this is we could have very positive emotions, because when a person is feeling good and happy, they're not going to have the anger response, even if they're tweaked a little bit. So they're very happy and they get tweaked, and instead of getting the full tweak, maybe they get 90% of the tweak, but they're not mad, so they're not going to fight it, and it's going to slowly die out if they get these very strong, positive, happy emotions. Another possibility is muscle relaxation, that you're going to tweak, but because I'm relaxed, I can't go the full way down, I'm going to go most of the way. And because I'm relaxing my muscles, I'm not going to hit it with that anger response, and I'm going to let it fade back. Tweak, fade back, tweak, fade back, and it can just die out. So the goal is to pair the trigger with a lower observed reflex. I don't want to pair the trigger and then get this with the tightening of emotion. I want to pair the trigger with, boom, a little bit less. And it's especially at that half second critical delay window, which is too fast to thoughtfully think, oh, I want to relax that muscle, right? The problem with this is that the counter condition is rarely stronger than that misophonia trigger response of the physical and that emotional ooh that goes with it. So these responses just don't die out. Well, I've developed a treatment called the neural repatterning technique, or the trigger with the trigger tamer app. And there's a video on that. And I suggest you watch that video for details of this treatment so that it drops off that reflex, because the key is to stop that emotional adder that keeps strengthening it. Now, it's sensitive to context, and with this neural repatterning technique, I've had some great successes with people. For example, the 15-year-old with his mom, the lady who triggered to her granddaughter, crunching, but not me. I've had some great successes with this, but I've also found that it's very context sensitive, and you have to treat the individual situation and sound that you want to change. I've had a teacher who was professional. She was a teacher. She was a great miso student, and she triggered to her students sniffing. She did the trigger tamer work at home, went to school, she still triggered. So gum chewing, I can do the gum chewing at home with my mom. Stop triggering to my mom, that can be very beneficial, but I go out in the public, I still trigger. So this neural repatterning technique can be super important for family and relationship triggers developed with close relations. So it still has a lot of benefit, and we have to figure out how to make it be better. So thank you for watching this video about human reflexes and misophonia. I hope you found it beneficial. If you have, I'd appreciate your support to the Misophonia Treatment Institute. We'll use those funds for education, misophonia awareness, research and development and improvement of treatments. We're making progress, but we need your help to make even more. So thank you very much.